even though I'm born in Prague and I'm Czech, I decided to mainly talk in English because there are other students from other countries which might not understand English. And because English is my native, it's still worse to present even talk. Train giving talks in English. I hope it won't make much difficulties. And if you don't understand anything, then just ask. I mean, not only if you don't understand my English, but also if you don't understand what I'm talking about. Because we will have a discussion and question after I finish with all the stuff. But I really prefer if you ask during the lecture or during the talk, because if you ask afterwards, then the whole context is lost, your colleagues might not know what you are asking about. So just go ahead, ask whenever you feel some explanation or you have some question or whatever. I don't really mind. The more interactive the talk will be, the happier I am. So I'm not going to talk about how does it feel if you decide to make your own Java virtual machine. Clearly there is no point to making yet another VM because the open source software is good enough. On the other hand, we are just feeling that we might find some interesting problems, and at least for me, the only way I can learn the programming language is to write a compiler, interpreter, and virtual machine for that language. And actually, before we started this project, I knew Java to that extent that I could write a program and probably use some frameworks, but During working on this, I found that I don't really understand what is the Java itself, the design, why something is designed in the way it's designed. So we learned a great deal. So if you want to learn a language, writing a compiler for that language, it's a good way to really understand. So a short plan of what I'm going to talk about. First of all, I will give you a little introduction of what the LibJava, the Java virtual machine I'm going to talk about, what is it, what is its overall architecture. I will try to stick down that for the very minimum, but I think it's important for you to get this basic understanding of what you see afterwards. After that, I will do a live demo, so I will show you some code that runs our Java virtual machine, or on top of our Java virtual machine. And we will see. But giving the live demos is always funky business. And then we will go through few examples, a few difficulties we run into, which we quite didn't expect, which was a bit of a surprise. And that's all. And I just wanted to show you some details that you might not be aware of, and the workflow we use to solve these problems. The little problem is that I tend to go to the very low level technical details, right? So as soon as you stop understanding this stuff, then just tell me and I will skip the rest or try to explain it a bit more on a higher level. But I know myself and I'm really a technical guy, so I unconsciously go to the very low level technical details. So stop me if that's way too much. Okay, so I'm going to talk about something we call STX with Java, which is a full Java virtual machine implementation built into a Smalltalk-X programming environment. And it runs Java, untranslated. It runs the Java bytecode as you can download it from some build service. This is how the whole system is structured, right? So here you have a virtual machine. This is a pretty fast Smalltalk virtual machine written in C mostly. It's a very tricky C at points, but it's still C. and on top of this, because you know that was initially a Smalltalk virtual machine, we have a bunch of Smalltalk classes which forms the basic collection and things like that, that makes the whole environment. But the virtual machine also can execute the JavaScript, so you can load the JavaScript code into it and then run it. And what we basically did, we extended it so it can run Java classes. Right? So there is a Java interpreter in the virtual machine. So in other words, the virtual machine can execute two different bytecodes. So the method can be either compiled into Smalltalk bytecode or the Java bytecode. We can use a JIT. So there is a JIT compiler that generates a lot faster machine code. And then on the user level, there is some of the runtime support. I will show you that later. And then you can load into the running system, you can load arbitrary Java classes. And we use the OpenJDK base library to get the basic Java library, like Java on Objects, which is fine because OpenJDK is now open source, so there is no problem with it. As I said, we started the project unofficially, just to have some fun coding. There are also other goals. One of the goals was that if we succeed, that's what we thought 5 years ago. If we succeed, we'll be able to run arbitrary Java code inside a Smalltalk, which would allow us to reuse Java libraries, which is nice. I mean, sometimes you have nice libraries in Java, right?
Do you really need that? Do you really need to reuse Java libraries in Smalltalk? Isn't Smalltalk expressive enough? Doesn't it have?
Well, the question is not about those libraries written in Java would use some super special features of Java, and that it would be impossible to implement the same library on Smalltalk. It's more about the library is there, it's debugged, so you can just use it. Right. That's why you don't. That's basically why you use libraries at all. It's not because you can't write them yourself. It's just,
for example, you would like to have better, XML library.
Yeah. For example, there is no conformant library to do relaxing validation on XML in Smalltalk because that's just a huge work. And this way, you can just load it and run it.
Yeah.
There are many examples.
Okay.
I mean, it's not always the best thing to do. But that was our selling point. Right?
Okay.
That was one of the selling points. And the other selling point is that, and this is very hard to explain if you are never exposed to Smalltalk, is that we wanted to push the Java development environment a step further and provide a Smalltalk-ish development environment. And this turns out to be tricky, but this is exactly what I'm going to show you. And you will see in a minute what I mean. And yes, besides that was, we will run a lot of stuff and we will have a great time and fun. And it was fun. Okay, so now it's time to to show something. Usually, my experience is that no matter how many times you try before, during the talk it crashes. Right? So, if you have rotten eggs and tomatoes, now is the time to get ready. Okay. Could you read it? I hope so. So, what you see here is a standard mode of X development environment. And I've prepared a simple, very simple example. I mean, it doesn't do anything fancy, but I hope it's simple enough to understand what's going on. So, here we have a simple instance of a loop object. This is the inspector, so this shows the live object which is in the memory and do something. This hello loop is a simple class, I will show you in a second. If you call start, it just every 2 seconds prints something to the standard output. The standard output is redirected to this window. So if I do a start here, it says something like, you know, hello world. Every 2 seconds. The thread is still running. Now I open a browser, which is a development tool you mainly use to write a new code and modify existing code. So, you know, if you are used to Eclipse, this is basically the class file editor. Except this editor works on the objects that are in the memory, that are live. So if I change the code here, the effect will be immediate to the running system. And this is something that is not fully supported in a Hotspot VM and in no other VM I know, which is, let's say, production point. So it still prints something, and here is the code run, so you see that, you know, there is a boolean that says whether it should continue or not, and calls the hello every 2 seconds. So, and here is the hello, which just does this print. There we go. What happens if I here change the code? So now I press accept, which means that the code is saved, compiled, and loaded into the running system. So if I do that, and if the system is you know, as live as I am trying to tell, then this output should change to print hello FIT. So let's give it a try. Still works. This is something really simple because you just change your constant. And this is to some extent supported in the Hotspot VM. But we can go much, much further. So, for example, what if we change this to print some counter? So we increment some integer variable and print it. So we will see, you know, one hello FIT, two hello FIT, and so on. Still works. You know, the thread is still running. I didn't stop the thread. I didn't stop the whole VM and didn't restart it. I'm modifying the running code. But still, this is not much. You can go further. So, you may say that this code is not nice enough, not very object oriented. So you may say, let's factor this out into a separate method. Something like this. And the question is, what happens if I accept, I mean, say, compile and load this code? First of all, this shouldn't be possible because there is no method hello that takes string. So in normal system, you cannot do that. It won't even compile. Not talking about running features. So what happens? We go to debugger. So we successfully compiled incomplete code, load it into the memory, and run it. And obviously, you get a debugger saying that there is no hello method that takes a string. For some, it might be this behavior might be weird. I mean, it might sound weird to load the code and run the code, which is not even compilable given the language specification. But if you are a better hunter and smalltalker, then you found out this kind of workflow that you are modifying the running system and programming more or less a debugger. Nice. In my opinion, it makes you a lot more productive because it shortens the development cycle. You don't need to, just imagine that you change something in a JPost server, right? You have to shut it down and load it again. Which I'm not a JPost expert, but I've been told that it might take hours. So now we can change the system while it's running. So okay, we introduce a bug, but we can just fix it in the debugger, right? So this is a debugger. You can see the stack trace, everything there. So we can say I'll just do a paste. Oh, it was too much. I'm a really bad typer. Here it's a system out print line that should be fine. So we recompile the code, but it's still stopped. And now we can say, okay, try again. We fix the code while the system is still running. So we do a resend, and you see that the thread just continues executing what it should. So this is the way of the workflow we wanted to support for Java. And I hope this is a proof that we succeed with that. But it wasn't. It took us some time to get this. And the rest of the talk will be about how we get there. Not about every single detail, because there are five years of first development, but just a few interesting moments, or at least, in my opinion, interesting. Okay, no crash this time, brilliant. So, when we started Patch is Good, we thought it would be hard, but there is a Java language specification. There's the Java virtual machine specification. So whenever we are in doubt or there is something unclear to us, we just go to the spec, read the spec, and follow the spec. So where's the problem? We thought that it will be easy walk like this. I mean, maybe long, but relatively easy. Like this lovely walk in Balmoral Castle in Scotland. So that's where the Queen spent some time. Nice. Okay. Well, man, that was way too naive. Way too naive. So in the end, it was like this. We struggled every step was a great struggle. We even didn't know where we are going. And just like this is in some anonymous pass in Jiangshan. and reader is better to make a nice bit. So, yeah, reader analysis. So now let's go for the very first problem, which, if you do this sort of work on Java, that would be one of the very first problems you encounter. So the problem is how the classes are loaded and how they are resolved. So imagine you're following the code. By the way, how many of you are familiar with the Java bytecode? Like that knows their structure and how it works. Okay, that's not much. Present again, I mean, geeks must exercise all the time. So. Okay, four people. Doesn't matter, I will go quickly through it. So if you have a code like this, then this particular method gets translated into the bytecode, and the bytecode looks like this. So, you know, it instantiates a new class, then invoke an arbitrary method to the constructor, then store it, because, you know, a star 1 means to store to the first temporary variable. Then load it again, funny, but it just stores and load it again, and then return it. Very simple, isn't it? But the question is, however, what are these funny numbers, right?
Magic.
That's the magic. That's the magic. So you have basically no, you know, in the bytecode there is the opcode for new. I don't remember what's the value, but let's say it's 155, and then 17. And these numbers are basically indices into the constant pool, and the constant pool is a structure that contains all the symbolic differences. So the new most likely need a class of which to create an instance. The class is described by the class reference. That's a special, you know, the constant pool may contain various different records, and one of the type of the record is the class reference. So this is the class reference, but the class reference itself does not know the name. The name is also, you know, indexed to the constant pool. So you go here and you find the ticket. You find the string here. So it's really like a, you know, nested and cross-linked structure. And the point is that at this point, everything is symbolic. You know, there are just strings. There are no offsets in the memory. There are, you know, no pointers to the class, which you need in the VM in order to create an instance. So this is basically what is dumped in the class file. So in order to be able to execute this new, you basically need to get a reference to the object in the heap, or in the Java method of the array in this case, and create, you know, in the memory the object has direct pointers. So you need somehow to get this object. And this process is called a resolution. And you need to implement the resolution in a way the spec specifies it, but it's not enough, as we will see in a second. So if you do this, it's relatively easy, okay? You just load the class, you find it in the jar, and then load it, and that's it. But if you are going to implement the virtual machine, then there is a lot of questions. Like, when the class is loaded? At what time? When the class is low, when the program is loaded, so if you type a Java, minus Java, whatever, at that time is loaded?
Nope, when it's needed.
When it's needed, but, you know, when it's needed.
When they need it. Yeah? Exactly.
That's the thing. The other thing is that, you know, there are static initializers. when those static initial arrays are run? That's the question. The other question is which class to use, because you might know that there is this funny class loader support, which you know most people hate it, because that's why you usually run out of bracket space. And that's why basically then in Java 8 why they removed bracket space, because people simply didn't know what is it and how to deal with it. So they make it a little bit more transparent. All the same, we basically need to know which class. That's not always clear. And in my experience, even long-time Java programmers couldn't tell me which class order loads which class. And if the class order is not, if the class is not loaded, which class order to use? That's the question. But as I said, there is this Java spec. So it's easy, just go to Java spec and you will get access. So we did. And so we go to the, this is one or two pages describing the semantics of the new instruction. You don't see it, but the second line refers to some other section, so you read the other section. I don't know, a couple more pages. However, they refer to another sections. And then you trace them down. if you do a breadth first search, and there are no more open sections or sections in the open queue, then you find out that you are pretty much through the whole spec, and there is no answer. Right? There is a lot of partial answers, but we wanted to know how it's from the very beginning, when the virtual machine started, because usually what you know and what is described in all internet resources, forums, and other guides, even in the programmers' guides from Oracle, it's when the Java VM is running and you want to load your own class. But we have no Java machine running. We want to start it up. So you say, okay, maybe we overwrote something, so you read the spec again. And then you go and find this very interesting statement, which basically says, the way the Java virtual machine is booted is unspecified. So we are pretty much screwed. The spec doesn't help at all. Anyway, 2 weeks lost. So we are at the very beginnings after 2 weeks speculating. And there are a lot more cases like implementation dependent or behavior undefined. So those you ever read a C99 spec, you are pretty familiar with that. Right? So now a bit experiments. And the thing is that this basically allows you to do it in the way you please. But we wanted to use the OpenJDK. And the OpenJDK is basically, the initialization routines. They are coded on the knowledge that they know the VM when it's done. So it works. But we don't know how it's done. We still don't know. Yet another month or two, I don't know how much time it took. We just, try to load the code, come up with some solution which we thought is sensible, found out that there is a cycle, so we cannot do it, and so on. So this is a sort of a problem which we simply didn't expect. We thought that the spec is complete, self-contained, and fully transparent. We found in the end that you cannot trust everything. So the solution in the end is that until the virtual machine is booted, we use a primordial class loader or a bootstrap class loader, which is hard coded into VM, And then we load the initial class of the user application with the system class loader. And since then, the system class loader is used. But there are a few exceptions. There is, for example, a special class loader implementation somewhere in the deep in the sun, misc, whatever, which is called a magic class loader. there is a class which is called magic class loader with no comments. One or two native methods with no comments. And apparently you run into it and you don't know what's doing.
Piece of magic.
Right? Exactly, that's where the magic happens. Right? But if you want to make your own VM, you somehow need to repeat that magic. Right? So, yeah, that's the first part. And we got stuck on this one. For some time. It took some time. And basically, the only way out of it is just to write a bunch of test cases and run them on the JVM and run them on your implementation and hope that if you are in sync, everything is okay. And if you find a case where it's not in sync, then you write a new test case and try to make your implementation to be in sync. So, you know, that's the student's favorite approach, trial and see. And we have to use it, even though we saw that we can do it, yeah, professionals, so we can do it better. No, we have to resort to this very primitive thing. Okay. We somehow succeed to make this running, and we were able to run on more and more Java code. And then it came to performance, because we found out that it's bloody slow. And, I'm a bit of a performance-oriented, so that's my favorite topic. And I did a lot of performance optimizations before, so I thought I have a relatively good insight into what might be slow and what might need optimization and what not. Big mistake. So if you do this sort of stuff, then the first problem is to identify the slow stuff. Right? Just to give you an impression, the Smalltalk X virtual machine is 250,000 lines of C code mixed with assembly sometimes. Right? So to get everything into the head and to get the complete understanding, in order to foresee what are the bottlenecks, that's tricky. But then there is another 100,000 of the basic Smalltalk library, and we use a Smalltalk to read the Java classes because it's much easier to program, for example, a class region can pass in the class file in Smalltalk than in C. You know, working in C is horrible. And then there is this OpenJDK base library. I don't know how many dozens lines of code. And if you don't know what is going there, it's quite difficult to foresee or to tell what takes time. Basically you have no idea what's wrong. It's just slow. So you start looking around, who might know why is it slow? The only guy that knows is a profiler. So you go to the profiler and then, you know, why is it so slow? But the profiler tells you no idea. And then you are feeling a bit desperate and say, hey profiler, you know, who might know? And the profiler says, well, if you give me a nice benchmark, I might be able to tell you. Okay, so it's, you know, there is a famous check table of, some animal asking for, I think it's a hen asking for whatever. So now we are completely out, and you say, okay, I must come up with a benchmark to feed the profiler, and the profiler might tell me. So you start writing the benchmarks, but then you find out that it's not just writing the benchmark, it's also having a way to run the benchmarks in a controlled environment. It's a way to manage the benchmark results, because it's nothing worse than you fix some performance problem, but because you cannot possibly see all the consequences, because this code base is so huge and the details are very, very tricky. So it many times happened to me that I fixed some performance problem at one spot and introduced a performance problem in another spot. So you need a tool that will automatically run the test, keeps the database of the previous test results, and you can consult this database in order to be able to confidently say, okay, this makes an improvement. So for a couple months you are completely sidetracked and you work on your own performance and benchmarking suite. We come up with a special framework we call Kaleta, which is a web-based interface that stores the results from the Jenkins build servers, so you can track and you can see what was the performance of the few commits before and things like that. And then you start to write the benchmarks, but you need to write various benchmarks for your various workloads. It's not like that if you write an application, then the workload is pretty much the same. Right? You know what your application is going to do. But here, you are writing a benchmark for something that has to run other people's code quickly, in a fast way, without being able to change that code. Right? Because somebody just may use a pool bubble sort instead of whatever. So you need to various benchmarks, and you need to know what the benchmarking tool, what the numbers basically mean. So yeah, another couple months, completely sidetracked, completely irrelevant for the VM work, but you have to do it because there is no way around. Okay, so if you do this work, then you feed the profiler, and the profiler tells you something like this. There are many profilers who use a call ring, because it is a very, very nice feature, because it's a simulation, more or less. It gives you the information about the jump, mispredicts, and cache failures, and things like that. And that really helps. But that's just the beginning, right? It's now you get a basic understanding what might be slow. Okay, so the first problem was that it was slow. And we somehow got a feeling, partially from the debugger, partially from some reasoning about the code, that the monitors might be a problem. You know, there's this synchronized keyword and synchronized method in Java, which are used to synchronize the multiple threads. Right. So we write a various benchmarks, and I would be quite interested in your guesses. Right. So the first benchmark is just the JVM boot, which means that you load the JVM and run the initial code to the point that the JVM is able to run your user code. So just before the point the JVM executes your public static void main. Right. So how many synchronized methods and synchronized blocks are executed just to get the system up and running? How much do you think?
Like hundreds?
Hundreds? Any other?
Thousands.
Okay, well then, hundreds.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a boot. That is a Groovy 3+4. You know what's a Groovy? That's a language written on top of JVM. So imagine you start the VM, load the Groovy, give your Groovy the thing, C++4, and get the 7 as a result. So how many synchronized methods that would involve? Hundreds? What do you think?
Like a couple thousands, 2,000s?
2,000s? This looks way too much for me. but yeah, that's it. And then there is a Tomcat startup. So you know the Tomcat server container. So the question is, how many of these synchronized methods are executed when you start it up? I mean, when you start it on the command line to the point that the server is ready to serve the first web page to the first client. So this is a grouping. And this is a Tomcat. So what's your guess for Tomcat?
1,000.
1,000, that's less than...
Yeah.
That's correct. Okay, 1,000. Let's see. We need to get these statistics before we dive into the system. So it means that we, again, something completely unrelated. We had to go open the VM sources, instrument the code with some performance counters, and collect the statistics. So this is a way how we do it. We use the dtrace or system top on Linux to get these statistics. So we have a process in the VM code. Quite handy. So if there is no typo, this should boot the VM and collect the statistics. It collects various statistics by the number of the monitors are hidden, so it's 6,800 and something. So it's in order of magnitude more than your guess. Okay, let's try the grouping. Well, actually, a lot of time is spent in this, you know, incrementing the content, right? Or it's crashing, that's other option. Well, you might laugh, but I found out that what if you run in the system tab, it sometimes modifies the behavior of your code. So, if you run something on the Linux on the system tab and it crashes, it might not be a bug in your code, but in the instrumentation code. But lucky enough, this works. Okay, 100,000. Nice, isn't it? That's 200 of my choose more than your guess.
Okay, then I'm according to my Tomcat. I was thinking about a million, and I'm getting closer, I think.
You are getting closer. Let's give it a try. Let's give it a try, right? Okay, I'm running terribly out of the time. Sorry. Yeah, that's a nice comment.
Who the hell is this MFH?
Okay. At least you see that it does something. It's counting like hell. Come on.
But you didn't say that you're gonna deploy many applications to Tomcat. I thought you said you're just running.
Well,
Tomcat
that's a default startup. So there's the, you know, it.
Yeah, but there are a lot of bloat in default installation.
Could be, but I mean the point was not to fix a Tomcat.
Yeah.
And I'm not a Tomcat expert, we just say, okay, Tomcat is nice.
Oh, it's easy, so RMRF and...
you may object that this benchmark is not correct. Yeah. We can discuss about it. Anyway, 700,000, which is close to a million. So that's completely unexpected. Right. My guess is initially there are, you know, 100, maybe 1,000 if you know the code is poor, but certainly not the 6,000 in order just to boot a VM. On the other hand, it kind of explains why the VM was so slow. So here are some statistics. And actually, the first number is the total amount of the synchronized method and synchronized code executed. And the second number is where there was actually a clash, where actually two processes contended on the same monitor, so try to enter the same critical section. Right? So you see that during the boot, out of 6,000 and something, only 72 times there was actually a need to do some special handling and to stop one cell and let the other go. In other words, in the rest of the cases, 6,000 and something, the synchronized should be just a no operation, so it should just go through and take no additional time, ideally no instruction. So this was a clearly suggested that we should really optimize the case in which there is no contention. Because if we optimize that, we solve a lot of problems. I remember like if it was yesterday, that we went to the pub for lunch, me, Marcel, and Klaus Gittinger, and we discussed these problems, and I don't know who came up with the solution, but somebody says, okay, if in the object we reserve a bit, which says, you know, the semaphore or the monitor is signaled, then the other step can check this bit, and you can switch to bit atomically. You can check this bit, and then do something else. And then we somehow evolve this idea, because you need basically two bits, and so, you know, it's a little more. But it's probably nothing you can't really work out in 2 evenings, maybe in a week of work. However, we found out there is a US patent of Sun, now Oracle, so we cannot use this trivial solution, we probably could work out ourselves. Anyway, there were smart guys at IBM working on a J9 project, which came up with a solution, which is in a way much better than what is the patented approach. But they published it in the paper, so we could use it, so we just take and use it. So it was a bit of a googling. The advantage is that it's a lot faster, because originally the monitors were, you know, there was a semaphore and then two queues in order to implement the wait and notify. So probably every monitor, enter and monitor exit takes a couple thousand machine instructions. With this approach, the most common case can be reduced to one or two instructions. That's a huge save. I'm running out of time, but I have prepared a demo to show you the effect on the living system. So, would you like to see it?
Yeah.
Okay, we might not be able to finish the whole talk, but... this is also a monkey business, because we already optimized the VM, so I have to hack the VM and disable this feature first. And again, if you hack the VM, things are likely to go wrong. So, now I prepared the patch and applied the patch to disable this thin locking mechanism, and now I recompile the VM. And now I can run the benchmark. So this benchmark, no. Oops. Okay. This should not be fatal. Okay. This is running a benchmark, and for performance reasons, it's always makes sense to run it in a jitter mode. And then the jitter is not perfect. We are still working on it. So the jitter here just dumps dumps some problems. But anyway, now introduce our original implementation. And then I will rewrite the tag, run it again, so it will see the speed up. So that's the point. And the benchmark consists of it runs a Saxon XSLT, I don't know, 1,000 times in some tiny XML, and then it computes the C++ using Ruby, a couple hundred times. I don't remember the number. The thing is that we are saying benchmark that runs in two different VMs, and we will see how much it will save. Okay, now benchmarking something. So it's 12,000 milliseconds plus something. For the Saxon, sorry, for the Ruby and for the Saxon it's a 9.5. Okay, so let's implement the synlocking. Page is empty. Recompile the VM and run it again. So how much would you expect to gain?
It's like a fifth of the time.
Sorry?
It's like fifth of the original time, I guess.
Fifth of the original time. That would be very nice. That would be very nice.
Oh, maybe a bit more.
And the thing is that with the benchmarks, you have to run it for a long time, because then there might be a lot of other activities running on your machine to basically screw your results, right? There might be some event from the network, so you need to run it for some time. Okay, 9.463.
Okay, so it's so like... 3 seconds faster.
Sorry?
3 seconds faster per case.
3 seconds out of 12.
Yeah.
Okay, so 1/4. It depends on the workload. So that was a huge, huge speed up. We optimized a lot of afterwards, but we never get such a huge speed up. So it's really worth to do that. And actually, I would never ever guess that the monitors are that heavily used. Okay, so that was one problem, and we used the synlocks. And you can go and check how it works. Or shall I explain now? Okay, the thing is that you have an object, and in the object you reserve a so-called block word, which is an integer, which is divided into two parts. Well, it doesn't work. So it's an integer, 32 bit. You can use a smaller one if you like. And there is a counter, and here is a thread ID. And basically the idea is that if no object, or sorry, no thread, owns the monitor on the object, then they are all zeros. They are all zeros, so it's empty. And if So in this case, you enter the monitor, and here in the counter you write 1, and here you write the third ID, which is also some number, right? And the thing is that in the code that does it, you basically check this word for being a 0, and if it's a 0, then you store this value, so the threat ID with the count 31. And because it's just, I don't know, 24 or 32 bits, you can do this atomically. And if you want to save some time for computing this, you can store this prefabricated lock word for this particular value with the counter 1 and thread ID in some thread local variable. So you load the thread local variable and execute test and set instruction, which is atomic, and most processors support it. So this is the most common case. Statistically, this is the most common case. There is another case, as you see, you know, this counter here can store in our implementation up to 256. You know, the counter can go up to 256, which means that 256 times the same thread may re-enter the same monitor. Right? So if the test and set lock fails, then you reach this value, the thread ID, and if the thread ID is equal to the currently running thread that tries to enter the monitor, then you just increment the counter. Right? And if this thread ID is not equal to the running thread ID, then it means that there is contention, and you do some fallback, and in that case, use the semaphores and the fully blown so-called fat lock. So that's the idea. Easy. We did it in a day. And basically, the most problematic part is to replace this sim lock with the fat lock in case there is no tension, and to get all the counters and internal variables correct.
By this approach, you use more memory, as you said in the previous slide.
No, because I need 32 or 64 bits more in each object header.
Yeah.
Right. Actually, in the original J9 virtual machine, they used other very clever tricks to squeeze the object header to 2 words, and still have 24 bits for the lock word. We cannot do it for various reasons, because we basically had no space in the object header, so we had to add extra word to the object header for the Java object. The smaller objects, they are, you know, untouched by this change. So the smaller object header is one word shorter than the Java. But it really pays off performance-wise.
And what happens if you run over to 256, if you re-enter?
If you re-enter, that's the same case like if there is another thread. Use the fat lock, which is a relatively huge structure in the memory that has a bigger counter set. Anyway, if you read the paper, everything's there, complete with statistics, power 4 assembly code, which is used in the virtual machine and things like that. So, you know, it's just a quick overview. So that was a one problem. Then we decided, okay, let's talk for 20 minutes more and then just finish, because we don't have this room booked for more than hour and a half. So another problem was how to cheat the code, right? You remember I was talking about the resolution, and the resolution is rather complex. You remember, you know, traversing the spec and the references, so it's, you know, 10 to maybe 30 pages, just this description how to resolve them. And if you cheat the code, you don't want to implement this in the assembly. Mm-hmm. That's very complex. And even if you are very good in assembly, then it won't help, because if this logic will be there, then the code won't be fast. So our very first idea was, okay, wait until all references are resolved. Because once the reference is resolved, once the path is resolved, it's remained fixed in the JVM. If you do this reloading and this live modification, it's no longer true. So it's yet another complexity into the problem, but just forget it for now. So we said, okay, wait until the code executes for some time and all references get resolved. And then detect the situation that everything is resolved and cheat. Because then you have the pass at hand. But it didn't quite work. We found that very few methods in a running system, even after you run a couple hundred iterations, very few methods are actually fully resolved. And this kind of illustrates this problem, right? Which occurs in the code base. Here you say get ticket, and you say whether you want a VIP ticket or a normal ticket, right? So, and the thing is that if you never pass the VIP as true value, then this class, this reference, this particular reference on this line is never resolved. And there is a lot of conditional code, as you may expect. So that's why a lot of methods were basically not fully resolved. So we said, okay, that was too simple, but we have to somehow deal with it. And still we don't want to implement this resolved in an assembly. Actually, you do it in C, but you generate an assembly. So, and now it's going to be tough. So, if you have an invert virtual instruction, and the reference is already resolved, then the cheated code looks like this. Who of you can understand it? Nobody. Okay, let's assume that's a pretty fast code. You can hardly do it faster, because this is just that you push the arguments on the stack. You have to follow a C ABI, and on an x86, arguments are pushed on the stack. So you push it on the stack, so this is argument 0, a funny structure called polymorphic in language. Yeah, that's how the magic happens, by the way. Search class, selector this, and then you just call the method. So you can hardly be fast. The thing is that if you call a method and it's not the correct method, and that's where this polymorphic inline cache helps and does its magic to resolve that situation. You know, if you have a virtual method like overwritten. So it's easy. And you see that here I do no resolution, nothing like that. This is a direct pointer. I know that the class and receiver and things like that, they are in a memory on a fixed address. I know the address, so I am pushing a constant. You can hardly be faster, right? It's a little bit more tricky because then there's a GC which may move object around. So I said it's a fixed address, but the GC may change the address, and you have to fetch this code. But you know, that was already there somehow implemented. That's all the magic that the VM guys has to do. But if this doesn't happen, this is the fastest code. If the at the cheat time the reference is not yet resolved, we generate slightly different a pro, different calling. So we push the arguments a little bit more. You know, there is no magic pick pushed because we don't need it. And we call a virtual machine function, which is implemented in C. Great, you can do it in C. It's much better than if you have to program it in assembly.
Nice that's name of the function.
Sorry?
It's a very nice name of the function.
Yeah.
It's C-like. Very C-like.
Well, the VM is in C. You can hardly expect it to be, you know, a slower, like. And this C code tries hard to do things, but most likely the C code is just a trampoline to this model code. And we say there is a funny Java VM object, that's a small talk object, and we pass the argument to the small talk code, and then we can implement all the resolution in nice high level object oriented small talk code. Great. That solve a lot of problems. So we have this pass compilation, and the scheme is written on assumption that if the code is not resolved, then it will be a little slower. But as soon as, you know, the fast pass gets executed, you know, the flow, the control flow that is most often executed gets resolved. And whenever we resolve and whenever we go here, we invalidate the JIT code, rejit it again, so we compile a faster version. So yeah, we thought that we will wait until it's resolved, so it will save us the tricky logic to detect these situations and reach it again. But unfortunately not, we have to meet. But the point is that we try to do as much in small talk as possible. but at the same time, trying to do only the rare cases in a small talk, and if we do something in a small talk, then cache it and generate a slightly faster way. Even though we did this, we found out that the code is still slow. And at this point, I was a little bit desperate. could be slow. And I found out that there is quite a lot of invocations in the Saxon benchmark that use this fun instruction, Chenka. So, but it really surprised me that the benchmark executes 1 million times, 800,000 times instance of. If you take any Java programming course, you will probably be told that using instance of is not very object oriented. Way of structuring your code, and you should avoid it, right? And then you use some Saxon written by a very smart guy, and found out, you know, 1 million, and an instance of, that's a bloody complex instruction, because it has to deal with all the you know, interfaces. So it's not just that you walk through the hierarchy, like through the class pointers and subject pointers, is you know, you have to do a breadth first search or depth first search, I don't remember which one you have to use, but one works on the other one. So I was really surprised. And the checkcast, I actually thought initially that the checkcast is also very rare, but whenever you have to, you know, upcasting in the code, there's a check cast that actually, that's the instruction that actually generates the class cast exception. So if the check cast passes, then it's no op, but if not, then it generates. They are very similar, but again, we use this fast path, but there was basically initially no way to do it in a fast way, so we always resort to calling back small talk, and then it was running slow. especially because it was used that much time. So this is basically a dump from the spec which says, well, that's the first half of the page that states the rules for the check cast, you know, when the check cast goes okay and when it goes wrong. So when you should throw a pass after the question. So you certainly don't want to do this, not even in C. Right? Because whenever you do it in C, you have this problem that the GC may be involved and it moves your objects and your pointers in your seeker are no longer valid. And that's a great source of problems. And if you don't handle this, you have a very nice segmentation violation. Right? So you don't want to do that. But resorting to this this code that implements this semantics that was proposed, we use a very, I think smart is not the right word. It's very
hacky.
Yes, hacky. That's the designation. But the observation is that the parameter to check cast is constant. The value is constant, it never changes. Again, it never changes in the original JVM and the, or in the JVM that following the JVM spec. But we have this reloading and live editing and things, and then it can change. Right? But let's say, make it easy, it cannot change. So the trick is very, very hacky. But the question is, do you know what is a polymorphic language? That's the funny structure. Okay, the thing is that the polymorphic inline cache, the problem in most of the dynamic languages is that if you call a foo, then you basically want to generate a call to the address of the foo. Right? The foo gets translated into some machine code, which has the address in the memory. You do the call, because this is what the CPU can do bloody fast. That's what is highly optimized in the silicon. However, in object-oriented languages, you have this nice polymorphism, which makes it nice to use, but hard to compile. So you basically, in the compile time, when you generate this a foo, you basically don't know the address of the foo. So there is this lookup logic, which consults, you know, the object class and looks into the object class for a method which is named foo. But as you may imagine, even if you use very fancy hashing algorithms with a, you know, very few crashes and collisions, it's still slow. So the trick here is that you first generate a call to the hub. Okay. So you generate a call to the helper, let's say __ send, which is a C function which takes a lot of time to execute, but the result of the send is the address of the foo which should be executed in this place for this particular object, for this instance. So you get the address, I don't know, 0x28, whatever, say 00. We have a very poor machine. So you generate the call and patch this call site to not call the send, but call this. So this is a, let's say, class A foo. So you are fast, but the trick is, what if this, if you enter this code again, and the A is not instance of a class A, is, for example, Bersen, right? Then the call to the foo is invalid. Right? It should not happen, because the polymorphism and the And rules of language says that it executes the overwritten method. So you generate here a little check. If the class, if class, like say receiver or this class, Rognas is equal to A, sorry, A, then go and execute the A. But if not, then call this send. And fetch this again to call a B true. So that's an inline cache, and there's a polymorphic inline cache which basically keeps a table. A go to this foo, B call something else. It's still faster than doing the foo lookup. So that's the polymorphic inline cache. That's the structure that was pushed here. Right? I have to push it because if the check fails, I have to update this polymorphic. Okay, so now maybe you are sensing what where I'm going to. So we know that the parameter is always constant. So the result of the check cast and instance of, basically, for the given class, depends only on the receiver, on the disk, on the class of the disk to be exact. So there is a special code that manipulates and abuses this polymorphic inline cache. And instead of filling the cache in a way that points to some Smalltalk or Java method, we store the pointer to a special VM helper method, which just return. Right, so we have this call return, but it's still not a lot faster than doing this, you know, full search through the interface. Maybe I can show you. Oh, that's probably my dream. So we use this sort of tricks to optimize the stuff. Because if then to the instance of a checkcast goes another object which is instance of another class, then the polymorphic inline cache fails, and we do this checkcast again. There was a little work to abuse the BIC for this sort of work because it's not really prepared for being used in this way. However, it saves a lot. Again, this was all about to illustrate that I basically saw that there is no point to optimizing the check cast and instance of, because they are rare anyway, so why bother? They are not that rare. We didn't know, we were too late. Okay, we are basically through. There was some, maybe I can go quickly, but this is how we do this live editing. Right? And if you think about it's like that you are in the jumbo jet going from Madrid to New York, and while in the ocean, you decide to fix your aircraft because it's not that nice and that fast. You might need a new engine, or there are a few more engines than you essentially need. So, and you somehow have to make sure that the plane is still flying. And that's the tricky bit. That's the bloody tricky bit. Especially because the spec is written, or the whole VM is designed in a way that this is not in the spec, this is not supported, it was not in the mind of the designers. So there are various obstacles. And one of the obstacles is, just imagine that you have this return ticket. So you compile it. This is the Java bytecode we know that this is the index in the constant pool, but if you want to execute it, you need the offset in the memory on which you find the desired value. So the common approach, which is also used in HubSpot, is that you resolve the stuff and you cache the value. Right? So here we cache, let's say it's on offset 8. So here we cache the 8, and we reach the code. So the loading sequence is just load the address of the object at 8 and load the stuff from the memory, which is pointed. However, imagine that you have a bunch of tickets in the memory already. You know, some guys got these tickets and had reference to those objects. And then somebody decided to put the contact name in there. Right? Then, clearly, the offset of the page date changes. But only in some objects. So the old objects still have on index 8, and the new objects have them on, well, it depends, let's say 12. And this is something that JVM does not really support, because once the class is loaded, it's fixed, you cannot amend it, you cannot add a new slot into it.
But HubSpot virtual machine supports class reloading, so...
Yes, but not to that extent.
Ah.
Not to that extent for the very same reasons. Because it's bloody hard to make it running, right? In HubSpot you have this hot replace, but you are basically limited to what you can replace. So you cannot... correct me if I'm wrong, but you cannot change... the signature of the method, you cannot add or remove the method, you cannot change the layout of the object, and you can't even change the maximum stack depth of the object, of the method.
So you can change basically only body of a method.
Yes.
Yeah.
But as I said, and as I showed before, in our implementation, you can even remove methods during the runtime.
Yeah.
But then we have these problems. okay, so the question is what to do. Whether to migrate the object. So we'll make sure that at any given time for one Java class with a given name loaded by the given class loader, that all instances have the same layout. So they have the same number of fields and things. But so this is a migration. So we might say, okay, let's just change the old objects just to relocate them, and you know, make basically a copy with this slot more. Or not to migrate, which means that you will have two versions of a class with the same name loaded by the same class loader, which is something which is not permitted by the spec. We decided to go to this multi-version system because during the migration, you know, cloning the object, that's easy. But then, you know, you have this initialization in constructors, and then you will find out that there are objects that are coded on assumption that something is never null, but you can't really execute the constructor automatically because you don't know what the constructor do. And if you don't execute it, then you know the value might be just null or zero, and the code might crash. If you don't migrate, the code might crash as well. But in SmallTalkX, if you change the class, there's the same approach. So you have two versions, and basically the old class dies when the last object, last of its instances, is garbage collected. So we decided to make the same decision here to make the system, let's say, more orthogonal. So if this happens, we have something like this, and if we for the first time resolve it, we have this, you know, this cached offset here. Right? If you change and introduce a new field in an unfortunate way that you specified not in the end, because if it's in the end, then nothing really happens. But if you're inserted here, then the offset of the payday changes, and you have to be a bit more careful, because at this time you have two instances of a Java class, but both have on a different positions, different offsets. So basically, you have to be very careful which class you use to resolve the offset. So in this case, in our implementation, this basically forbids jitter to jitted, and we don't cache anything. So when we execute this method again, you know, this get field, the new class is resolved, because then we have the particular instance which has a direct pointer to its class. We resolve that value, use it to load the data, and flush the cache. So the code is bloody slow, but the observation is that sooner or later during the development cycle, the old classes or old object instances for old classes go away, and at this point we switch back to the normal solution and cache everything and jitter everything.
And then you also have to handle instance of, right?
Sure.
The new and the old class.
Yeah. Then we have to handle a lot of other things. Right? We have to invalidate the code, flush all the inline caches, flush the native code. I don't know what else. I mean, somehow works. I have to read the code to tell you what. But it's rather tricky. If you do this sort of work, then you have to kind of think about this. Okay, another thing is that you do overloads, so that's not really that interesting. Okay, I ran out of my time, so the talk was basically two times longer than I initially intended. I should have expected it, I know myself. Anyway, the code is publicly available, you can download it, play with it, give feedback, or even join the development. Now it's time to go and have some beer and discuss even further. If you have questions now, then just go and ask.
Are you familiar with the project DCEVM, Dynamic Code Evolution?
They do pretty much the same.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
On the hotspot VM. They don't support all the operations we support. However, it's hotspot VM. Mm-hmm. But basically, Marcel can tell more because
he
did the normal section.
Changes to the superclass hierarchy. So you can change superclass of the object, mm-hmm. as far as I'm aware. But yeah, they used the standard OpenJDK and they built the support to the OpenJDK. So.
But I mean, 5 years ago when we started, there was no DCE. Or maybe there was, but it was not publicly available.
Yeah, we published the papers more or less in the same year.
Yeah, I think.
They were faster than us, but not as much.
Clearly, they did not copy that.
They don't.
We have comic records from time before, but it was published, so we can prove a prior out. Any other questions? Okay, I hope it was interesting for you. Now it's too late to complain, so. Okay,
what's the next step?
The next step, that's an interesting question. The next step, now we learned a lot, and for example, using few other tricks I did before, now I've found out that, for example, the checkout optimization is way too tricky. In a way that it's done in the VM level. But I think I can do it on the Smalltalk level using just the Smalltalk code and features exposed to the Smalltalk while preserving the same performance. So, you know, optimizations like this. For example, we don't yet support the uninvoked dynamic. The VM has a different hook which is, in my opinion, a bit more general. But yeah, working on that. There is a lot of work on the tooling. You know, because the VM, that's such a tiny stuff. Bloody complex, but it's such a tiny stuff. Right? And you do the reloading, you can do somewhere here. But as you see, we have a compiler that can compile incomplete code. We have the IDE with you know, all the search for references, syntax hiding, and stuff like that. So the scope is like that. Right? So we are being a bit more overwhelmed. But there is a lot of work. And now we have something that is running, and we can play with it and get the feeling. Right? Because when I talk to Java programmers that do Java for many, many years, they are usually scared by just by thinking about that the code is modified while it's running. It's something that is inherently dangerous, which it is. But my experience is that the development is much more pleasant than it, because you have basically zero turnaround.
Well, Java is not about pleasure. It's all about money.
Yeah, but let's leave this non-technical discussion out of this room. Okay. Or switch the camera off. sure. But but still, there are poor people that have to do Java. And we are showing them that it could be a lot more fun than it is.
There is hope.
There is hope, yes.
Yeah, throw him away.
Is this having a production usage? Or are you planning to?
Yes, there are plans to. Or actually, it should be in production in a couple of days because there's this release. Mm-hmm. But whether they will finally release it and ship it to the customers or not, I don't know. Mm-hmm. But certainly, I have developed a production ready tool using these features to support a customer's problems. Or solve customers' problems by doing some funny tricks and provide them a tool which happens to run on this VM. Mm-hmm.
Is it possible to call a small talk code back from the Java code?
Sure, and the other way around. That was. Basically, I don't know, yet another year of work, and I just skip it here because I already kind of knew that I am going to run out of time. So yeah, we can talk in another hour about problems like this. And there were, basically, I thought we might just rewrite some selectors, you know, because the syntax of the Smalltalk in Java it's different. In Smalltalk there is no method overloading, and if we solve this, we are pretty much done. Big mistake, that was the easy part. The tricky part was exceptions. Because the semantics of the exceptions is completely different, the implementation is completely different, and to be able to catch a Java exception in a Smalltalk code, or have a handler for a Smalltalk exception, which calls some Smalltalk body, and the body happens to call a Java, and the Java then happens to call Smalltalk again, and then this Smalltalk rises the exception which is held there, right? So in the stack you have a mixed Smalltalk and Java frames, and the exception is handled, thrown in from the Smalltalk frame, handled in the Smalltalk frame, but there are a couple frames in between shell and Java. Man, that was tricky, right? Because there is the exceptions itself were relatively easy. I mean, it took me just months to implement it. That was relatively easy, but there are these monitors, right? And the finally blocks and synchronized basically are compiled into the exception handlers. So you cannot just, you know, blindly skip if the, if it's a small talk exception, you cannot blindly skip these handlers compiled into Java frames because there might be artificial frames, artificial handlers, which just leave the monitor. So you somehow have to pass the small talk exception into the Java code, but the Java compiler obviously doesn't know anything about the small talk exception. You know, it has a completely different API, right? So at this point, we have to trick the Java to think that it kind of works with the Java instance instead of small talk instance. And the thing is that, you know, everything is synchronized as you see. So we have to solve this because if you miss a single synchronized, so a single finally handler for a synchronized method, then everything falls apart. You know, the image just, you know, slowly freezes because it just waits for some locks. But the frames which would unlock the monitor, they are no longer there, right? They are unharmed because of the exception handler, and you are screwed. So we have a couple seconds and then the image. So yeah, there is a, you know, this another Pandora's box of problems. And I just decided to skip it because that was just too much. But you can do this. You can do this. That was one of the goals that we have to be able to do this. Otherwise it would be quite pointless, right? If the goal was to call the Java library, you wouldn't be able to call the Java code. It would kind of spoil the whole point. Yeah. It was.
How many people worked on it?
Well, there was some initial attempt done by the Klaus Gittinger in 1996 or 7. And then he made it to the point that he can execute some funny applets with the JDK 1.0, which are shipped with the JDK 1.0. And then he was like, okay, I can do it. Enough, there are other interesting things. And basically the code kind of rots in the repository. And 5 years ago, we said, okay, let's give it a try. And to this day, I rewrote probably 99% of the original code. But it was a good starting point. And I mean, you know, there was a Java 1 or Java Beta 1.0, and now we have a Java 8, right? The shift was huge. I mean, there are no class orders. You know, even the semantics of a few inflection changes. So we didn't start from ground zero. All the same, we have to destroy every single again. And it was mostly my work, Marcel did some work, and there was another guy who is now doing a PhD in Bern, working on this for, let's say, a year. But it was never a full-time project, so it was, you know, more or less hobby. So, I don't know. Yeah, very few people, 2 or 3 people, including all the IDE and all this stuff.
Okay, so finally, after 5 years of hard work, you can finally use your favorite XML parser, Java library, in Smalltalk.
Yeah, from this point, it's crazy. But I like it a lot.
Yeah, I understand.
Maybe I may sound a bit arrogant, but I think I know a lot more than the average Java senior programmer.
I believe
about
so.
The Java itself. I don't know the frameworks, but I know all the dark corners, including the magic parser.
I can imagine that.
So from that point of view, that was great. You learned a lot.
I don't know Smalltalk well, so it may be a silly question. Does Smalltalk support Maki patching, like Ruby and...
Oh, what do you mean by that?
You can add some methods to existing object or class.
Well, actually, there is no other way how to can program in Smalltalk other than do Maki patching.
Yeah, so the second question, how...
That's what I basically did with Java.
Yeah. do you know something about the Ruby refinements future from 2.0 to 1?
Not much.
It's like easily I think monkey patch to some scope. So when you monkey patch some class or object,
okay,
it's
so
not
it's something like selector namespaces or class boxes or something like that.
It's selector namespaces but bigger or less.
Right. Okay. I know what it is.
Yeah, so is this supported in Smalltalk and how have you deal with this in this implementation?
Well, it is supported in Smalltalk in a way that the Smalltalk supports the selector namespaces. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean that they are used heavily, but we have an implementation of a selector namespaces and it's tested how it works. Mm-hmm. So we can do this on Smalltalk. Right. If you ask whether we can do something like these refinements or selector namespaces on a Java code, we can't because we don't have a Java compiler support for it. Mm-hmm. But that's just the tooling and compiler work. Mm-hmm. Because in the VM, we have enough support to do that. Mm-hmm. For Smalltalk, we already have it. For Java, somebody has to you know, implement the parser and the compiler that can work with this feature. Mm-hmm. So, to some extent, yes, out of the box now.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Pop time. Okay, thanks for the